Hello, and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and arts calendar. Tonight, in place of the cinema, we're very pleased to welcome Some Families, presenting Remembering Martin with students from the John F. Kennedy School, based upon the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. For our state of affairs, we are pleased to have again Charles Achie Odong, Dr. Temba Kadali, and special guests Norma Tata and Dr. David Makoyengo. Last but not least, our arts calendar, with special guests from the Marlane Dance School and our special guest artist, Professor Gail McKinney Griffith. Stay with us, and remember, you are participating in The Collegium.
This presentation of Remembering Martin is brought to you by Some Families, a society of multi-ethnic families. Some Families is a group dedicated to fostering the positive self-awareness of all children, particularly those of multi-ethnic or interracial backgrounds. The 13 performers are elementary students from the John F. Kennedy School in Zehlendorf, Berlin. Our narrator is Ty Thomas, a student of music and a graduate of the John F. Kennedy School. In a day when young people are hungry for honest heroes, we would like to remember a man whose life truly did make a difference. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. believed that the dignity we strive for is dreamed of and indeed destined for every man, woman, and child. He wanted us all to be able to soar and believed that, yes, we too can fly.
The year was 1930. In the city of Berlin, Germany, a young African-American contralto made her European concert debut to overwhelming critical success. Marian Anderson's was a voice you were privileged to hear once in 100 years. She was the first black woman to sing solo at the Metropolitan Opera, and she was a friend of Martin Luther King Jr.
He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 Dr. King used to love to hear me sing that song for him. He also said I had God's special gift. But you, all of you, must believe that everyone has a gift for something, even if it is the gift of just being a good friend.
Another friend of Dr. King was Rosa Parks, who has been called the mother of the civil rights movement. She was arrested on a bus in Montgomery, Alabama, when she refused to give up her seat to a white man. The year was 1955, and her decision catapulted the young Reverend King into the curious and watchful eyes of the entire world. Yes, Rosa Parks was tired.
Yes, I was tired, but only tired of always giving in. That's what I told Reverend King. There'll be many times in your life when you will have to make a decision and you will be alone. That's what I learned back on the bus of Montgomery.
She continues to this day at age 84 to encourage young people to read books rather than watch TV, always ask a lot of questions, and fight racism and discrimination. She says, it's the right thing to do. By traveling to India, he studied and discovered firsthand the teachings of Mahatma Gandhi, which led Dr. King to take a more peaceful, nonviolent approach to solving the great civil rights problems in America.
I would have been proud of him, like a father to a son, when he won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1964.
As president, John F. Kennedy knew that change was coming, and he recognized that Martin Luther King Jr., with his sense of courage and conviction, was at the front of this great wave sweeping the country.
In 1960, I said to my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. Then I met with Dr. King. I heard his voice, I looked into his eyes, and I knew he was the kind of American I was talking about. He knew we were in this together, and he believed in us all.
As one of the first black women to reach international stardom, Josephine Baker was a singer, a dancer, and even had a short career as a French spy. Her 12 adopted children from many backgrounds were lovingly referred to as her Rainbow Tribe.
When I performed, I always work for the rights of my people. I'll tell you this though. I was there back in 1963 when I heard him say, I have a dream. And I knew our time was coming. We were entering a future I had always hoped for.
At the same time, Malcolm X, a leader of the black Muslim movement in America, was also trying to effect change and influence the future of black America. He, like King, would meet a tragic and violent death.
Sure, brother. You can say, Minister King and I took different roads, but we both ended at the same final stop, didn't we? You might try to say something wrong like, our goals were different, but freedom now and for the future was the end we both wanted. And now you tell me, friend, are we there yet? Are we there yet?
One of the most uplifting scenes in recent memory was the release after 27 years from a South African prison of Nelson Mandela. Born to be the leader of this African nation, he continues today to be a symbol of freedom and hope for the future.
Freedom! Africa! Free!
These are the words my heart has been saying since a long, long time. Not just for me, or for myself, Africa, but for all. For all!
The spirit of Dr. King lives on in Mandela's words. It also is evident in the life of Olympic champion Jackie Joyner Kersee. Considered by many to be the greatest woman athlete, she works today to inspire young people around the world to always keep trying, even in the face of difficulties.
As Dr. King always said, let nothing stand in your way. I didn't even let asthma stand in my way. I always had something to shoot for each year, to jump 1 inch further.
Basketball great Isaiah Thomas has similar words for people young and old on how to never give up through your struggles. He said,
I have always believed no matter how many shots I miss, I'm always going to make the next one.
Many of us were witnesses to what seems to be the instant stardom of 21-year-old golfer Tiger Woods. Now, more than ever, the doors that Martin Luther King was knocking on are opening up wider and wider.
I am the youngest golfer ever to win a master tournament, but I will always be thankful to those who came before me to help make golf a game where all people can be included.
There is an African proverb that says, if we stand tall, it is because we stand on the backs of those who came before us. One person who stands tall and proud today is the Reverend Jesse Jackson. He has been a leader for the rights and privileges of common and uncommon people all of his life. He learned from and worked personally with Dr. King and was with him just before his death on April 4, 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee.
Dr. King taught us well through his life and death how to live with courage and conviction. Even to this day and beyond, let us keep his hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive.
The great African-American poet Maya Angelou spoke from her heart when she wrote these words.
When I think on Martin King, shattered youth of days gone by, Lord, we all were different then. Who can say we aren't changed and renewed once again because of him? Let us achieve a future meant to be.
Reverend King's widow, Coretta Scott King, along with her four children, continues today her husband's hopes for civil rights for oppressed peoples throughout America and the world. In keeping his spirit alive for now and future generations, she said it simply and best for us.
He did not belong to us. He belonged to the whole world.
He belonged to the entire world, Dr. King said about himself. He was not just an American citizen, but a citizen of the whole world. For that world he lived, for that world he died, and for the future of that world, we remember him still.
But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside. From every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Four, three, two, one.
Hello, and welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program. Yes, indeed, we're pulling it together. Welcome back. And we're very pleased to have with us our usual commentators, Dr. Temba Kadali and Charles Achiye Odong. In addition to that, we're very pleased to have Norma Tater and Dr. David Makoyengo. We'd like to talk a little bit this evening about, shall we say, the state of affairs in the mother country, that is, the mother country, Africa. I'd like to begin with the first question, and I'd like to direct it, I'll leave it open to whoever wants to jump in and deal with it. I'm very interested in the pre-colonial, colonial, and post-colonial history of the Democratic Republic of Congo, which was formerly known as Zaire. Norma, would you like to handle that hot potato?
Yeah, it's not easy to.
It's a big cake, isn't
yes,
it?
Certainly. Yes. Would you like to begin, Mr. Achiye?
Well, as we can see, the history of the Democratic Republic of Congo, as we know it today, is complex, I believe. And one has to see that before the colonial governments came to Africa, we had a people
I think we're experiencing some technical difficulties, but I'm sure we will get it correct in a few seconds. Love will find a way.
Yeah, the history of Congo is very complex as we know it, and this takes virtually a long time. I'd like to move, however, a little forward and turn the whole thing around and bring it forward to what is happening today in the Congo. Let me, for example, bring in the recent problems that make us talk today about the Congo. This is the Tutsi Hutu warfare. And what is the basis of this problem? What caused this kind of hatred? Is this ethnic problem? Is this class rivalry, as sometimes when we read history books we are told? Or what is the influence of European politics in this kind of situation? David, you like to start with this?
Yeah, I think I would just like to put that matter a bit clear. The Tutsi-Hutu problem is an ethnic problem. It has been there since the colonial time, and up to today, this is a very, very serious problem. That I think you remember in 1994, the war in Rwanda, whereby the Hutu-dominated army committed genocide. So this is continuing on and on. It's an ethnic problem. Now, in Zaire, the Tutsi are doing the same business. So the problem is going to continue on and on, and we don't know how long it's going to continue. So might be, if you have something to add, I think you could.
I wouldn't like to call this problem ethnic. I think it's more a classical problem. Let's leave the ethnic aspect aside. In Zaire, there was a dictatorship, and that was Mobutu, who was sponsored by the Western countries. And then Kabila, with his ambition, ever since he was 23 years, he has always wanted to remove Mobutu. He wanted to remove Mobutu because of the way Mobutu came into power. Mobutu came into power because he was assisted by the Americans. by the Secret Service of the Americans. The Americans, they supported Mobutu because Mobutu was pro-West, and then that time there was a leader who was anti-West. He was a socialist. He was a pro. He was a sympathetic person to communism. That was Patrice Lumumba. And then he killed Patrice Lumumba with the help of the Americans. And then they accepted this, the Americans accepted this in the Tagesspiegel, not even in the Bild Zeitung, in the Tagesspiegel. I read this 2 weeks ago, that they admittedly, they openly admitted that they did support at some time and stage Mobutu to be what he is, to be what he was, and to be what he is today.
Timber.
Yeah, when we switch on the cable nowadays, we're rather confused about all the different so-called ethnic groups in Central Africa at war with each other, allegedly. What is the role of the countries surrounding Zaire, like Angola, Uganda, and Rwanda, in the frame of that conflict? Zaire.
Your question is not very clear.
Okay, the question is, what is the role of the neighboring countries? Somehow they are also involved in that conflict. Like we see that Rwanda and Zaire, for instance, due probably to the ethnic groups which live on both sides of the border, going back to the pre-colonial time, that these groups are also involved in that Zairean conflict. Like, for instance, the what is the name of that people? Yeah, for instance. And could you tell us about the interference of the surrounding countries, surrounding Zaire, within the conflict? What is the role in that? What is the position, for instance, of Angola or Uganda concerning the political change in Zaire?
I would comment for Angola. Angola was devastated, terribly devastated. Since independence in 1975 by neighboring countries, that is Zaire, the past Zaire, and South Africa.
How did that happen?
Savimbi, with the help of South Africa, infiltrated Angola, and Angola was terribly devastated. We are speaking of Angola today, a country that is with landmines, infiltrated with landmines. Yeah, you can't move by a truck in Angola because there are a lot of landmines in Angola. And this was a South African sponsored movement, through Savimbi. And it's logic now that Kabila is getting assistance from the present government in Angola. It's logic, that the soldiers in Angola are assisting Kabila now to remove Kabila. To remove Mobutu out. Because Mobutu has always been an object, a puppet, either of the South African government or of the Western countries or United States, CIA.
Okay, if I add to what you have just said, I think you are blaming Mobutu so directly. Mobutu is just somebody the United States was using, right? Savimbi was being held by United States to remove a communist government. The Russians were supporting MPLA. UNITA were being supported by South Africa and the United States. Mobutu was just a channel where they channeled their arms, right? So Mobutu should not be blamed to that extent. You should blame United States. Reagan knew exactly what they were doing, because when Reagan meets Savimbi, he goes through the front gate. Savimbi was like a president of Angola. He was a very well-respected person. So Mobutu is just somebody they are using to channel their arms through. And when you talk about Kabila, Kabila is also a puppet-like. It's being used by the other six countries for their own interests. Do you know why Kabila is in Kinshasa today? It's just because there was an uprising about Ranyamulenge. That was never there. The Tutsi-dominated army is in Uganda, is in Rwanda, Burundi, and it is in Zaire. You saw what happened yesterday or the day before? People are already very fed up of Mr. Kabila's soldiers. They say they are Rwandese. They are not Zairans. That much you have to pay attention to that.
But
now, let me just come. Give me a chance, please.
Yeah.
When you talk about Savimbi, yesterday already the Angolan army has attacked Savimbi. They wanted to make sure Kabila is there, supply line is cut, they can go for Savimbi, and that's it. Where are they going next? Vice President of Rwanda was asked by some BBC correspondents before yesterday in London, are you going to Kenya or are you going to Angola? So this is a business that these people are carrying on and on and on. So Angolan war was a war between the United States and the Soviets. It was never Mobutu. Mobutu was a channel because Mobutu, they used him. He has $4 billion. They know it is government money. There's no problem. So long as Mobutu can siphon money out of Zaire, he can channel the weapons to destabilize peace in the next country. It is very okay. That is the point.
Okay, I'd like to just ask you to just hold your point right there. We're going to go to break, try to clear up our technical problems, and we'll be right back. Remember, stay with us, and you are participating in The Collegium. Welcome back to the Collegium. And now we'd like to give the lady an opportunity to respond to something that she feels somewhat sincere about.
I beg to disagree with the speaker, the former speaker. The conflict in Central Africa is no longer a West or an East conflict. It's a regional conflict. These East-West blocs ceased to exist since the fall of the Berlin Wall. So much so that you can't really say that Mobutu was after 1990, you can't say Mobutu was pro-West and the other one was pro-East. Russia ceased to exist. The Soviet Union ceased to exist. Yeah. So much so that what happened in Central Africa is mostly regional and ethnical. Yeah.
So if you look at it, I mean, to add what, these problems have been there before. I didn't mean that Mobutu, second it is today. It began then and it continued, right? So the East-West bloc were so much connected with this problem. When the Berlin Wall did not exist, which means the problem also ended according to you, but that's not what happened. It continued. Mobutu still remained, but Russians were there, Americans were on the other side, and that was it.
Following that line, it reminds me of the way we began the questioning when we talked about pre-colonial, colonial, and what some people refer to as the neo-colonial relationship that exists between Africa and the West. It seems to me that one needs to consider who's controlling the economic strings of the situation, and then to some extent we can see how regional the situation is, or whether or not there are other very serious and important and significant influences that are dealing with the continent of Africa. Along those lines, I'd like to ask, are there similarities developing between the Berlin West Africa Conference of from November 15, 1884 to February 26, 1885 upon Africa? And how would you compare that with the French and the United States positions regarding Zaire and its neighbors?
Yeah. I think there is a lot of similarities. The 1888 Conference of Berlin, it was different in a way that they discussed and they divided who takes what. But where we have reached today, I mean, the French are the losers and the Americans are the people who are gaining. So in the sense is that nobody is saying take this. They are not dividing anymore. They are only taking. See, the French, Francophone countries that tend to be Anglophone, and that is so good for United States and Britain.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, who is taking what from where now at this present, moment? Who is taking what and from where?
Okay, let me, what I want to say, the countries which are supporting President Kabila of the Democratic Republic of Congo, they don't have even enough money to finance the economy at home. So United States must foot these bills. That much you have to understand. Those weapons are coming from somewhere, right? And they cost a lot of money. African countries depend on what the Europeans and the Americans give them. And they cannot survive without anything. When the Europeans and the United States isolate you, you should know that your economy is totally down. And that's how it works.
Why has the French lost?
The French has lost because during the colonial time, they really did not take care of their own territories, in the sense. So it seems to be the economical situation also has not been the best, given that Zaire is a very rich country, but they just left everything the way it is. And the Americans come in, and now you can see President Kabila had already contracted when he's in Lubumbashi. He was not yet the president of the Democratic Republic of Congo.
Well, I'm a little bit confused, because if we talk about French and Americans, what do we mean? Do we mean the government? Do we mean companies which are based there? I think basically, if we look at the world today, the economic monopoles are no longer national. So it is more or less, when we talk about French America, we probably use the term countries who are based in the Western Hemisphere. Maybe that would be a better term to describe the situation. Now, I want to know something concerning the basic issues and the key factors influencing each other. I think when we look at the situation, we have a rich country. We have a lot of poor people in that country. We have a few people who have access to political and military power. And we have outside forces who want to utilize the resources of that country. I think these are the four factors who are influencing each other, more or less. In that sense, probably it's very good to think in non-ethical terms, but in pure economical dimensions. If we look at the situation that we have like a $1 billion contracts on the table, irrespective of what philosophies people follow, the temptation is very high to get hand on those contracts and to get the money out of the situation. I think that is what probably everybody would do who has access to these huge amounts of money. In that sense, I would like to know, how do we see the perspectives now of the situation? What can we contribute, or what kind of solutions are there for in favor of the majority of the inhabitants of Zaire to get rid of that very tragic situation? I think when we talk about personalities or persons, Mobutu or Kabila, I don't know if that leads us to anywhere. The question is, what kind of system, what kind of mechanism can we develop to get out of that situation?
Yeah, I think, first of all, we are talking of what you're saying is better say about the market economy. You see, the person who leads the state is the one who is the head of the economy in the country. So when you're saying we are talking about Kabila or Mobutu or anybody, it matters a lot who leads Zaire or Democratic Republic of Congo today.
Well, without a doubt, because as I said, the temptation is a $2 billion contract. The majority, even of leaders, will not withstand that temptation, and they will, by military force, try to get their hands on that contract. And the Westerners will do probably the same. That is nothing which is specific for Africa, that is only human. In that sense, I doubt very much if we have that amount of money on the table, irrespective if it's Kabila, irrespective if it's Mobutu, whatever kind of person will get hand on the situation, will get the money to the people in the country.
Mr. Chairman, first of all, the very fact that they are American businessmen at this time in Congo, it means that Kabila is inheriting what is already existing. These Americans were already there before Kabila conquered Lubumbashi. So he is inheriting the American contracts. He had to rewrite them. So in which way can you then point fingers at Kabila and say?
Well, basically, I think it's correct to think that the pointing of the finger will not solve a problem. I think the moral implications, or to point out the moral implications that people exploit a country, I think will not solve the problem. The question is, what can we do from our point of view, to contribute to the situation, to ease it for the majority of the people in that country?
I do believe that if there is a democratic government in Democratic Republic of Congo, that will solve the problem.
What do you mean by that, democratic government?
Oh, I think at the moment it's too early to say something like that. I mean, President Kabila needs time, but there is, for example, Etienne Tshisekedi, who is an opposition leader, and President Kabila said when he comes to Kinshasa, they will try their level best to have all the democratic forces together and build the country. But it did not work like that. When they came over, his foreign minister, Dr. Karaha, said they don't even know who Tshisekedi is. This is a gentleman who has been fighting nonviolently for over 20 years so that they could get Mobutu out. But in the end of the day, people are back in the street. The honeymoon for Mr. Kabila is very short. And I think the high time they try to unite and build this country together, it means it will progress. But at the moment, I don't see any prospect.
What role do you think Tshisekedi should play, if any?
In fact, I was pleased to hear, when I read the Turkish speaker today, I was pleased to hear that Tshisekedi was refused a post. Perhaps for Mr. Tshisekedi, it's hard. But for democratic-minded people, I think it's a chance for Tshisekedi to build up an opposition force in a democratic country against Mr. Kabila. We need this democratic opposition. There is nowhere in Africa where really there is an opposition. Yeah. That is very strong, like Tshisekedi's position right at this time and at this point in time.
Will Kabila tolerate the so-called democratic opposition? Will that be allowed to flourish is an interesting question.
I don't think so. They made it very clear that they won't tolerate that. So I don't think Zaire or Democratic Republic of Congo needs some sort of opposition. They need to put this country together. This is the only way.
A quick answer.
Yeah.
Is there any area where Kabila can learn from previous liberation struggles in South Africa, in Zimbabwe, in Angola? Short answer.
South Africa is a good example.
In Zimbabwe, in Namibia?
Zimbabwe does not have a government of national unity. It's only South Africa, and that is the best example Kabila can rely on.
There is Mandela a lot. I beg to disagree with you.
Thank you very much.
There is a lot to be learned from Zimbabwe. There is a lot to be learned from South Africa. There is a lot to be learned from Mozambique.
Why?
And Angola, and Angola as well. These countries, either they had strong oppositions or they lacked oppositions. Speak for Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe in the early 80s, Mugabe was irreplaceable. Mugabe did extremely well after the struggle. But then the thing is this, what Mr. Kabila has to know is that when you do very well in the 80s, like what Mugabe did, he did extremely well in 1980 until 1990. Being ZAPU as I am, I was in the opposition. But I cannot imagine a leader better than Mugabe in the 1980s.
On that note, as we examine the pages of history and look forward to a bright tomorrow, we're going to have to close this session of State of Affairs and move on to our arts calendar. Stay with us, and remember, you are participating in the Collegium.
Oh, girl. joy she brings me. She brings me joy. She brings me joy.
Check one, check two. I can't hold back.
Girl, you're my joy.